So, okay, thank you to all the panelists, and just quickly to sum up, this panel was of course about stereotypes, we can all saw that and hear that, and it's also about the different concepts and construction of us and the other. And what was really very interesting for me, but I hope also for the others, it was just how many different tools were used to analyze this. So we had the social linguistic one, and the visual one, and the one from literature, and of course, the most probably a new approach is the use of the new media. And now the floor is yours, so you can start to ask questions. Yeah, please, can you please stand up? Okay.
Question for Karen. You talked about the selection of postcards. And I'm wondering, what percentage of the postcards did you look at? Did you throw or did you not include because they were boring, didn't have any kind of thing to do? How can we situate this in kind of the nationalist postcards with the kind of non-nationalist postcards? Sort of, you know. And the other thing is, wondering about there's a slight danger of overreading some of these postcards where, say, the picture may be quite, have some national symbolism or whatever, but the message doesn't. And to what extent is it the person who picked up the postcard because it was a postcard to hand, it was, there's no message being sent by the choice of the image, but the, you know, we're perhaps reading back something that wasn't there in the sender's intention and isn't there in the text either.
To avoid to overinterpreting something, we have two methodological steps. In the very first step, we always we really count postcards. So with a big collection in tabular form, we really count how much items there are in which language. And I can tell you from all I've seen so far, the overwhelming majority of it is in German, as well as the printed language, as well as the individual languages. Especially from tourist places or places along the railroad, because also a lot of past buyers, I mean, wrote postcards from their journeys. So, as I already mentioned, a very small part is only Swedish, which also speaks for the fact that German was mainly used also as lingua franca. So, also in between the language of communication, like it is English today, was back then German. And then only a very small percentage of those cards are scanned, and we plan to build up a digital platform, a digital archive of all those postcards, which should be online in about a year. So we are right now in this collecting phase. So you also have to imagine that for every postcard, we have to inventorize it. So to date postcard, when was it sent or when was it produced, collect metadata. In about a year or so, those cards should be online. It should be also a research tool for you, so for teaching, for other scholars as well, not just for us. But this is upcoming, so I will inform you in the future once we are online.
Yes, I dare to ask a question. The last speaker, I think you have not addressed a very crucial question, whether political purpose of it, namely reclaiming territory that was virtually or potentially Italian and reclaiming it for Yugoslavia and basically making it sound natural that people speak a sort of Italian Croatian mixed hybrid dialect and see them as our people rather than potentially theirs. Isn't that the kind of the whole underline of this project?
I would actually say no, because, I mean, what is actually striking for me in this like Yugoslav-Italian connection is how easily Yugoslavia just like put everything on the side. At least when it comes to like these kind of encounters, because you can really see, so basically like more or less parts of the conflict was solved in 54. This is 16 years later. For instance, in the music case, I can give you the best case when it comes to music. So Sergio Endrigo, Italian like singer, who was from Pula, and he escaped in 1947 with thousands of Italians, and so he was 14 years old, so he remembers that. And he comes to Split to participate in Adriatic Nordlist, which in these days were international, and like all newspapers say, oh, he's partially ours because he's from Pula, but no one says why he left. And like even better, he's the only one, because he also feels himself as part of the culture, he is the only foreigner who decides to sing in original language. And like, there is literally no mention in Italian newspapers, and he was big name in Italy, and he was big name in Croatia, and like or in Yugoslavia, and no one like single mentions, and even like Tito here before says openly to Italian minority who comes to Italian culture or something, who comes to Yugoslavia, says Italy and Yugoslavia are the example how like two countries with different systems can coexist and live together. So it's like, for me, it was also really striking that they could just, you know, like already in 1958, when all this mass culture like develops, how they had, like, for instance, Yugoslav radio television has agreement with RAI to show their TV programs in the first 2 years, experimental programming, and from 58 they are even showing their news, the main news, because the director of TV Ljubljana said, are so, you know, like confident that our system is the best one, that they can and they should watch foreign like news because they know how to, you know, like differ truth from us. So like this idea is completely kind of like left over. I think the difference is that when we look at these kind of programs, what the people from the coast think and what the people from the other part.
And not to forget Sanremo, which was so famous in Italy as it was also in Yugoslavia.
Yeah.
But I think I slightly see quite a difference here, because it's like this was the Italian stereotype, which is really how the Italian is, was in this serial put into the stereotype of the Yugoslav person. So for me, it's a kind of tricky and a political issue, even if you're saying that it is not. But it can be perceived this way in order for the people in the Introterra to say, to accept the people from the Adriatic part. Since we know that part was not a part of Yugoslavia for centuries. Yeah, next questions. Okay, Marco, can you be so kind?
Yes, please
to. No,
please,
yeah,
please.
Please.
Oh, but I have one quick question for Anita and a quick question for Clemens. Anita, you mentioned that the show in the first season dealt with the years of the 1930s.
Yes.
So I'm wondering how a show that depicts this Mediterranean life like this can depict the and manage and negotiate the events of the war in the 1930s. And then my question for, and still be what it is, and my question for Clemens, it's a bit of an observation. I've read a lot of fourth-rate novels written by people from language frontiers, but not about Bosnia. And from everything you said, I didn't see how the colonial situation or site of what you were talking about was any different than what the writers I read had said, and the way they characterized other people in their communities, not their own neighbors, in other words. So I'm thinking of novelists, like Bartsch or Mahner or Mahler, who write these bizarre language frontier novels that are fun to read because they're so bad. And then, can the subaltern speak? My immediate thought was, of course, in your novels that you're talking about, it's one question. But if I think of court cases, it's a completely different question. Then I'm not sure if there is a subaltern.
Yeah, I'm just like looking through my notes what I wrote about this this first part. And I mean, there's no, so one of the things that I did mention is like it actually shows how little these villages do change through time. So there is no so much reflection about like what's going on in the rest of the world.
Or even collaboration or occupation.
No, because they're of course all they all went to partisans. I mean, like you know, it's like really simple. Like even the doctor who is kind of bourgeois. Even he goes because he's a doctor, so he helps them. But there is an interesting part later, which is, I think, kind of like a criticism, when the village becomes touristy, and then the first Germans arrive as a tourist. And then basically Rocco, the guy who is like really entrepreneuristic, so he says, okay, so when Germans come to this house, tell them that the Italians burned it. And when Italians come, tell them that the Germans burned it. So there is just like this, like no one collaborated, you know, like. From like people here, non-collaborative, you can just see how this first commune basically became, you know, like bribed by the power once when they got there.
Well, very briefly, I think particularly the colonial pattern in Michel is very evident that here a person who is not really from the center, but in comparison to Bosnia, Herzegovina from the center, speaks on behalf of a native who is basically depicted as too dumb to think for himself. So this patronizing attitude is very typical for and don't forget the underlying discourse of the Austrian civilizing mission in Bosnia, which is, if you look at all the ways how it is worded in official documents, it's very close to what colonial powers did to justify their basically the conquests. Of course, and I think one of the oldest questions is, well, internal colonization versus external colonialism. And I think it was Beyendorfer, it's a very recent volume by, I think, historians and social scientists saying, and actually, these are both sides of the coin of imperial rule. A system of a hierarchical ethnic difference on the inside, in a way, equals, for example, inequality towards the outside. And so there are these mirror phenomena. And of course, you could say a Moravian recruit is probably treated not in a very, what would be, say, a Husulian recruit from Galicia would be treated in a pretty similar way, or kind of patronized in a similar way. That is a part of the question I'm raising, because we have this kind of cliche in our heads that colonialism happens overseas, it doesn't happen in Europe. And actually, by being Eurocentric, we tend to forget that colonialism has happened here, for example, in Ireland and in other parts of Europe, which I would like to bring to the fore again. And the strongest case I can make is Bosnia and Herzegovina in the Habsburg field.
Yes, actually, a small remark. And how much could you go further from this very short, further from this Mediterranean story? I will emphasize socialist story, because I haven't got an idea how many series were simulating this success. There was a Slovenian series at the beginning of the 80s called Our Local Community. It was all about the late self-management socialism. It's great. It's actually, at the end, it's local community. It's like it occurred to me, it's similar as the Malamis. So they're there, they try to avoid all the work, and actually they have numerous meetings, but they all want to gain something. And at the same time, it's also a postman, and people are also playing. Like this, you don't know the series, it was quite big at the beginning of the 80s, from 80 to 84. But the person who wrote the script was Croatian origin, Marvic. So I suppose I just want to make a reference, there's not an idea. I've used this when I had a lecture 1 month ago about on the self-management. And actually, it's similar. It's the Malmö still emphasized this, the life in late socialism, trying to emphasize this, that, okay, maybe it's funny, but still we have fun. It's stupid, we don't understand late self-management, all those institutions, but we have fun. Something about that.
Thank you.
Tom,
do you
still
have a question?
Yeah, you can see your hand before. No, okay, sorry. So, any other questions? Okay, please.
This is a question for Susanna. You drew our attention to more German language examples of these Jewish Burgesinger that were going on to these different capitals. Were they predominantly singing in German? Or I'm also kind of curious whether or not you had mentioned how they were playing in locations that specifically allowed Jewish performers. And I think you mentioned that, maybe I misunderstood. But I'm curious whether that also influenced what kind of audience came to these types of performances as well, if you can speak to that.
The last part I didn't understand acoustically.
Sorry.
That's the last sentence.
just whether you can speak to what kind of audiences came to these events.
Yeah.
I know that's sometimes hard to find.
Okay. So the problem with the pieces is, of course, that this is a performance, and I have a textbook from this. So the only way, in my opinion, to can get close to a performative approach or to the performance, if you don't have any medial aspects, is to read the critics in the newspapers. So to get any information about how the audience acted and reacted and who was the audience in a way. So this is the one side, and the other side is that the censorship sometimes get again after after approving it, visited the audience, the performances, and made notices what happened during the performances. So these are two ways to can get a bit closer to the performance itself. Those plays I introduced today were German. In German, had to deal with the Austrian censorship in Vienna. So those are staged in German, so in the combination of the various dialects. But the same play, so the same song from Risa Bastet traveled with the same song to Budapest. It is quite interesting and difficult to say, because from Vienna we have different newspapers who report on the performances. But I didn't get so far any information to the performance in Budapest of those two, but just of those two. At the Sechen Library, where those books are stored, they are also in German. So there is a supposed German-speaking censor. I would say that those two pieces, those two examples, were staged in German in Budapest too. But the most other pieces were translated. And I'm not sure yet who translated them, because they are then in Hungarian, for example, in the archive. And it's kind of difficult. So sometimes they do it for kind of similar audience, and sometimes it is completely diverse. And you just can get hints through the critics in the newspaper, I think. But I'm very happy with any hint I can get.
Last questions? Question? Okay, yeah.
Okay.
See you now,
Kevin. No, I did, yeah, I suddenly was inspired by the great line. So I have a very quick question for Kevin, and then we'll have Ethan as well, if that's okay. That'll be very quick. Kevin, my question is, are you going to look at the addresses of these postcards as well? Could that tell us something?
Where they were sent to?
Yeah, I mean, because it would be much better if we had external addresses, wouldn't it? But I'm wondering if you had a sense of social history at this time, you might be able to make some.
Yes, but you have to keep in mind that only a very small number of all postcards circulated back then made their way back to the archive. So even if you have statistics on where those few postcards were sent to, you still have just a very tiny percentage. So when you work with the media of postcards, you always have to keep in mind you can never reach for full quantities. You will never achieve it. I mean, of course, to all the parts of Habsburg monarchy, of course, you have, especially the big city centers, so a lot of course to Graz, to Vienna, also to the Czech transfers, so far, Hungarian news you can find very often on postcards as well. And of course, in also local contexts, so really within the region.
Okay. So you're a little bit like a fairly modernist from the English, you have to extrapolate from a fragment of extant materials.
Yes, but you can never really reach for an overall representative approach. You will never have that in postcards.
So, if I have a quick question for Anita as well, if I make this very quickly. Okay. I just wanted to hear a little bit more about the topic of Mediterranean. Will you be exploring other manifestations of this phenomenon? I was just thinking about Mediterranean games and these sorts of things. And the second part of the question is, again, very quickly, how far back do you think this goes? I mean, thinking about Salovieri, Brothers, a couple of years ago, there was a special edition of the Austrian History Yearbook, which Borat Kleinbaum and Igor Chukarin contributed articles about the Adriatic in history and memory. And I wonder, actually, if we're calling things different names, this might be. And I just enjoyed that.
So I'll give you shorter, then later I can give you one. I had Mediterranean games in my initial research, but then I gave up because it's not that relevant to the general public in India as I thought in 50s and 60s and 70s, yes, but in my time span, no. The second part is the thing is there is a break, I think, after 45 that makes Mediterranean specific because of the decolonization. I mean, it becomes because of the Cold War. So basically, you have everything. You have capitalists, you have socialists, you have dictatorships, you have like all these decolonized countries, and you have Israel. So it's kind of like it really gets messy, and I think, and I believe this is the reason why there is no the idea of Mediterranean after the post-Second World War, because it's really hard to like grasp it. So I think popular culture could be the way, but, and I work, so basically I have three case studies. It's popular music, the one I mentioned, television and fashion. And to all these goes tourism. So like I kind of incorporated tourism in all my case studies. But I can tell you more.